Let's talk about inflation because it continues to rage out of control. David made the point earlier that when gas prices went up, the government said that gas prices would come down because we were releasing some emergency stores. That so far has yet to happen. And, you know, the way the media is spinning it as if like it's this crisis, it needs some sort of emergency intervention, we need more stimulus, right? But it's important that we all sort of take a step back and say, who is this really hurting? Because the middle class, the chat room always laughs when I use that term because it's pretty much disappearing. But anyone middle class or above is not really being harmed by slightly more expensive eggs, right? It's the lower socioeconomic status that is hurting. But it does seem like a great way for the government to promote its own interests by ways of out of control spending and low interest rates, right? Go ahead, Clayton.
Well, I was going to say that you know, the Daily Poster did a really interesting look and deep dive at this, and David Sirota over the team over at the Daily Poster. You talk about great independent journalists. I think they do a great job, and he laid out exactly six things that they're not telling you about inflation, right? And I love this. Of course, they use the CNN, the average family. Video where they did the interview with the family that has 11 kids or whatever. Like, we sat down with an average family. No one has 11 kids. No one does. Anyway, breaks down that corporate media isn't reporting the full story. And when they talk about just like rising prices, that's just a fraction of what really is hurting the average American. And what they're also not telling you, the corporate media is ignoring, is that corporations and CEOs' profits have skyrocketed. So they're not telling you that side of it, that the reason that they're doing fine is because their salaries have increased tremendously. The corporate profits have been off the charts.
But so has the balance sheet for the Fed, right?
Right.
And so the Fed has been, what they're saying is like doing this, buying up, what they call it, quantitative easing, right?
Right.
They're buying up funds in order to help the economy. But what we don't really know or what we don't really see is what's in those funds that they're buying, right? Recent reports are that the Fed actually hired BlackRock to buy into exchange-traded funds that they own, right? So they're BlackRock managed ETFs that now BlackRock manages the government buying their own funds. And what's in those funds? Home Depot, Walmart, right? So
Wait, say this again.
Just let me finish this point.
I know, but this is such an important point that I don't want people to miss this, because if we talk about on the show, it's easy to throw around this idea, the Fed, a bunch of criminals.
Right.
The banks are all in cahoots with these guys. It's a drug cartel. And when we say that, it sounds like a fun kind of clickbait talking point. But when you actually look at the structure of how the Fed operates, it's 100% accurate. That is exactly how the Fed operates. It acts as a cartel.
So the Fed is pretending that it's buying up these junk bonds or like struggling companies, right? But they're doing that by way of exchange-traded funds. And what's in those exchange-traded funds is not really a struggling company. They may be some zombie companies, which is another thing. Put that in your pocket. But inside these funds are stocks like Microsoft, Home Depot,
Apple,
Walmart, Apple, right? So while small businesses are struggling, the Fed is buying up businesses that are not, right? And by these journal entries, inflating what the Fed has so that they can continue to lend and bring more money in. So inflation is actually quite good for them because it gives them the excuse to make these sort of cronyist moves. It gives them the excuse to keep interest rates low, which then also inflates the federal budget. And the resulting, the sort of natural economic result of that is inflation, which doesn't hurt them. It only hurts people on the bottom. This economist, I've been reading this book. I've mentioned The War on Small Business. She says the economic recovery is more what she calls E-shaped. So you imagine the horizontal lines that make up the capital letter E. So those on the top, big business, juiced by government and the Fed, stay on top or grow. Those in the middle probably aren't hurt or helped very much, but those on the bottom are the ones that are really getting burned by lava, right? This is what's happening. This is why the media is going crazy with inflation, because it helps government, it helps the people in power in the government, it helps the big banks, and the media is in that bed too.
And further, it helps big business. So one thing that's been left out of this entire story is these massive profits, right? Mm-hmm. You know, David and Ellie, we've been talking on this show about all these insane profits for goods and everything else. Well, guess what? That, who does that benefit? So they're Chipotle raises its burrito prices, but they also post record profits. So they're yes, their burrito costs more, but they're also now having record profits. Do you see that? Some it's not like their profits are down because their prices are going up. As the Daily Poster points out, have you noticed stories in the mainstream media about expensive essential goods don't mention the record profits of these companies selling them? This is not an accident. The discourse is being rigged and manipulated by media and political voices so that the conversation serves the business interest and donors benefiting the status quo. Make no mistake. Higher prices are annoying, and for 70% of households with an annual income below 40 grand, they are causing financial hardship. I mean, look, we just talked about this story the other day about how inflation is causing hardship for 45% of U.S. households right now.
But that is not why the media wants you to panic about this, right? The media wants you to panic about this so that you are in favor of more inflationary government spending. And so you think, well, and then that $1,200 stimulus check that you cash comes at a higher cost to you. So you think, oh, good, I got $1,200. That's going to help me out for a while. It's not, because it's going to cause more inflation in an economy that you have to live in. And that $1,200 is going to be worth less and less and less. It will buy you fewer and fewer things. And it feels more and more like these stimulus are blood money. They're getting you to say, I need it. I'll cash it. Please spend it, the government. But then it hurts you. If the government really wanted to help out small business or small town America, Main Street instead of Wall Street, a stimulus for just small business would have been to the tune of $1 trillion. Done, right? But the stimulus that we had went mostly towards big business, not small business, towards universities that never lost any money because students paid in full for their tuition. So where did that money go? They took the cream off the top, gave it to big business, gave you the peanuts, and then those of us who are suffering from inflation say, please, sir, can I have some more? And when we cash it, it costs us more because the government keeps giving to their buddies. It's really pissing me off.
Yeah, I mean, just look at this. Inflation at the very top. Perhaps the most important point being overlooked by the corporate media is that inflation is being driven by the greed and power of wealthy people and corporations. As banks notched record profits, executives are finding ways to juice their salaries. There's a 20 to 30% private jet inflation right now. Why? Because by booming demand from rich people who saw their wealth soaring during the pandemic. So they have all this extra money laying around and they're needing to spend it. So, well, I know, David, you just bought a private jet, right? I mean, all this extra money you had laying around.
Yeah, but it was a cheap one. But you know what? A lot of people forget too is like, this is the Federal Reserve is a private bank. It's not even federal. The government does not own it. So there's no oversight. They're sending money wherever they want to send it. We can't get any kind of accounting of where the money goes or anything. So this is a private bank that is ruining our economy and sending money to, you know, Wall Street and their cronies, and while we get nothing.
Right. So we can fight about what we can afford, right? Like, oh, we can't afford more stimulus. Oh, the budget's going crazy. We don't fight at all about what wars we want. National defense? No, totally fine. That gets increased.
Or if a corporation needs bailed out, it's there.
It's fine. As he points out right here in the piece, there seems to be an unspoken rule among the corporate media that when it comes to fear-mongering about government spending, the deficit and the inflation of the U.S. military budget doesn't matter. And it isn't worth even discussing. In fact, intervening in overseas conflicts, killing civilians, siphoning public money to military contractors have all proven to be major contributions to inflation. The Vietnam War, for example, this is a good historical lesson, wasn't just long, bloody, and unnecessary. It was also inflationary. So it led to massive inflation. Look what happened in the late 70s, for crying out loud. Look at interest rates in the early 1980s, where interest rates were 18, 19% interest rates. So, yes, you know, runaway wars, nonstop spending by the Federal Reserve that benefits big banks and Wall Street leads to inflation. But they want to scapegoat you. They want to say that you because you want a better wage at McDonald's, it's your fault.
I just don't understand how they cannot look at this as like simple economics. If you would stimulate the middle class, everybody wins. Wall Street wins. Everybody wins if the middle class is stimulated, because the middle class spends money. And who takes the money we spend? The Wall Street, the big companies and stuff like that. So they think completely backwards. They bypass the middle class and send it directly to their cronies, thinking that that's the best way to do it.
And it does not trickle down. We know no. Right? And so I think a good takeaway from this is, when you hear the media screaming at you about inflation, you must know that that's good for the media, not just for ratings, but because it's helping their buddies, right? You must know that when they say, well, see, inflation's so high, we need more social spending, we need more government help, right? But that is also good for the government. When they're telling us interest rates are low, we need it that way, that's good for the government's budget, not necessarily for yours, right? And so America is on this, like, our economy is on drugs right now, and we need these constant quick hits. We cannot allow for a sort of correctional move in the market, because we haven't like built up our tolerance for it. So these are things that you then can question and realize, okay, but when I ask the government for this stimulus, I realize that it's going to cause more inflation because the government's going to keep its own rates low. It's not really doing this for me. And so any stimulus we take is going to mean that we suffer inflation and those things can purchase less. And it's not your fault for needing it. The government wants you to think it is.
No, and as we
pointed, it's not your fault that inflation results from that. And it's also not your fault that they're skimming peanuts off for stimulus and then big fat checks,
right,
for tanks.
Well, as we talked about last week on the show, I mean, right, during the lockdown, all of these small businesses get crushed. All of these people get forced out of their jobs, particularly hit areas throughout the southern part of the world where they don't need to be inside, but they were told to go inside, and crushed, you know, thousands of people, millions of people dying as a result of this, these draconian lockdown measures. Who benefited? Big business and Wall Street benefited from these lockdowns.
Yes.
And who got crushed? Well, small businesses.
So the government is literally picking you losers and winners. They just choose, right?
What about the CARES Act?
Well, the CARES Act, a lot of people, you know, they named this bill the CARES Act. It was going to help the people. But $5 trillion was transferred to the big corporations. 800 corporations got $5 trillion. And I don't even know what we got. We got $1,200 stimulus checks.
We were talking about last night in bed. This is literally what we were talking about last night in bed, that the Kennedy Center honors, like, you know, when this stimulus package was coming together. That's why we always say there's only one political party, right? Republicans and Democrats are one political party that only benefit Wall Street. They can pay lip service to cultural issues over here and stuff like that, but they're, at the end of the day, they just are there to serve Wall Street. The Kennedy Center honors. The Kennedy Center was thrown in a whole huge stimulus.
$25 million was added by Nancy Pelosi into the CARES Act.
For what?
After Republicans drafted the first round, Nancy Pelosi took it and added a bunch of what they call pork, right? But in it was $25 million for the Kennedy Center for a national endowment for the humanities and arts. Now, I'm not saying arts aren't important, but this was the heart of the pandemic, when we were really only concerned about not dying and not going broke.
Well, and who's she to just randomly pick it out of a hat?
Well, you know? That's like, the thing, right? Is because the Kennedy Center was not hurting.
What about
actually
the bakery down the street? Like, why didn't she pick that bakery down the street? She just randomly picked
200,000
right.
Small
the Kennedy
businesses.
Center specifically had received $68.3 million in federal grants between 2010 and 2019, and had assets of $557 million. Just let me finish, please. And so if the Kennedy Center really was hurting, why couldn't it have gone through the normal channels that every other business had to go to? Because the endowments were not precluded from PPP loans. You could be a nonprofit. Any business could apply for a PPP loan. Why give them direct money and not say anybody, right?
Is she on the board?
I'm actually not sure, but it would be interesting to see who. I mean, clearly the Kennedy Center is like a who's who of. Right. I mean, they do that big, like, giving out national honors to like Tina Fey and David Letterman, right? It's a big PR move to say, like, oh, we need all this money for arts and stuff, and then also directly from your tax bill. That is unconscionable.
Right. Yeah, and again, you know, these stimulus packages that went out were benefiting Wall Street, and then, of course, they become vilified. They're like, see all these stimulus that we just randomly gave out? Well, no, if you actually break it down, it didn't go to average Americans. It went to Wall Street, and now you're complaining about it. This is what led to runaway inflation. You know, and we should also point out here that the Federal Reserve Chief Jerome Powell, I can't let him off the hook on this, so he gets re-nominated, he gets re-elected, what, a week ago?
Mm.
Before he gets re-elected, he's basically, he's telling all of us that inflation's transitory, it's going to be done in like 2 months. And then the moment he gets re-elected, like the next day he tells us, I was wrong, he didn't even say I was wrong. He said it's going to continue well into 2022, maybe even 2023. So, I mean, come on. I mean, literally, you're telling me you couldn't have said this a day earlier, but then you get re-elected, and now you feel free that you can just tell us the truth about how inflation is going to be running for the next year and a half?
Yeah.
I mean, you're full of crap. I mean, we can see right through it.
I love this comment in the chat. Joshua Wilson says, I feel so powerless. What are we going to do about it? I don't know. I feel the same way. And, you know, when you really peel back this onion, you're like, wow, I don't know who to yell at or what to say or what to... I don't know. But I appreciate you giving voice to that. And I just want to...
Well, and that's the thing. I think that's by design.
Leave the United States?
Well, yes.
You could leave the United States.
Mr. Vice President, I'm speaking.
That's easier said than done.
You are so today.
You've been speaking the whole show.
Mr. Vice President, I'm speaking.
Listen.
I'm speaking.
Listen, Kamala Harris. You've been speaking the whole show.
You can't let me finish a sentence today. I'm going to just start kicking you under the table.
I've let you finish multiple paragraphs.
David, can you ring in on this? Be the judge.
Well, don't make him the parent.
Don't make me sit between you guys.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
Well, I mean, you could. I mean, you say, what do we? I feel so powerless about it, right? So, where does the powerlessness come from? It comes from feeling like you can't get a leg up, right? You can't improve your family situation, and there are a number of things that you can do to improve your own personal situation. Are we going to end this corporate greed? Probably not. But what can you do in your family to empower you and your family to protect yourselves? You know, starting a small business, taking action that's outside of this corrupt government banking system. You know,
learning to do better with the assets you have. Learning to pay down your liabilities, right? There are things you can do with your own personal finance. In fact, I will take this opportunity to tell you that we have the Financial Freedom Academy to help you do just that, to learn how to build one asset at a time inside of your family so that you're not owning government fiat currency, but things that you control. Please do visit financialfreedomacademy.com. I think it's a fantastic course. But beyond that, yes, you can sort of not fall for it too, right? Like, you can talk to your politicians and say, I don't want this or I don't want that, based on your own informed opinion.
Right.
I'm Mr. Vice President. I'm done speaking.
Oh, you're done now? Okay. Yeah, you can vote with your ballot. You know, you can vote with your vote, right? And kick these people to the curb and demand change.
But we can't. That's the thing. We can't. Like, every time, like, how does somebody like Mitch McConnell, there's something in there that gets these people back in office. It's like they never leave, even though there's elections and everybody complains about him. I've never seen one person be like, I really love Mitch McConnell. But how does he end up back in there? Like, the elections don't seem to work, you know? And it's like, I think the problem is we have so many things that we're overwhelmed. And I think that's by design. I think that they know that if they keep us divided left and right, we're never going to come together. Like other countries, if you mess with education in other countries, like, the whole country goes and protests. We are so singular issue focused that we focus on these one single thing. So we'll have 10 people go protest about this. Then we got 5 people over here protesting about this. When the thing is, we all should be focused on the roots of the problem, and that is the government itself, and we should all team together. But that's not going to happen if they keep us divided by all these issues.
Well,
look what happened.
Lawrence Lessig did run for president on this very platform, but he just was a bit too
wonky.
It's just a bit too complicated for most people. Then most people don't take the time to educate themselves. But he did have a presidential run in 2020 to specifically end the entire lobbyist and corporate interest influence in government. So it's
Who's
not
this?
Like Lawrence Lessig.
Yeah, Lawrence Lessig. And, you know, but it's much easier to vote for a guy who gets up there and says, you know, we're going to build a wall and Mexico is going to pay for it. Like, easy headline, you know, easy red hat with an easy headline. That's easier for Americans to digest. They just don't want to spend the time. They don't want diving into it.
They have the money to keep it in our face all the time through advertising, where these other people, if you don't have a huge ad budget and nobody, like, I don't even know that Lessig, I never even knew he was running.
Yeah.
Read the book Republic Lost. It's a really good book about how corporate interest controls our government. And he did run for president, and his whole platform was, I'm going to destroy the lobbyists, and then I'm going to give over the job to, I don't know who else. Like, he didn't really want to be president. He only wanted to disrupt this. And he has a formula for who else wants to run in order to do this. But it didn't work because Americans just don't have the attention span. I'm sorry to say that. I don't know if I should say that. Like, didn't have the intention span to understand it, or because he wasn't sexy enough, or I don't know why.
When I see people arguing for term limits, that people are arguing for, like, they, as if we're going to get somebody good in these two party systems. But all that does is makes you lazy, because it's like, let's find ways that we can still be lazy and not look into people and actually see what the content of their character, rather than, you know, what we see on advertisements or whatever. People just, they don't want to look into it. There's too much. Like, they're like, I don't want to take the time. Like, and then who is even asking the questions that we need to know these people? Like, you've got the media will softball questions to these candidates and be like, so how's your family? What's your position on this? They never really hold them accountable for anything. So it's like, we are uninformed, and it's not really our fault.
Yeah. Well, we're also victims of the book massive media as well. You know.
Yeah, exactly.
Republic Lost by Lawrence Lessig. So if you really want to make a change, you also could run under this platform. He did. He wrote the book. He believed in something. So it's possible. Change is possible, but we have to pay attention to the things that the media doesn't want us to pay attention to and do research for ourselves.